Say, are good leaders born or are they made? And I suppose there might be, let's say, if I was to guess, 20% of us human beings who have some sort of genetic or family flaws that were so damaged that we can't learn to be leaders. And I suppose that's true. But for the vast majority, if you look what it takes to be a good leader, it's a set of skills that just requires time, mentorship, and trial and error. And when I look at what great organizations do that develop leaders, that's really what they do, is they put people in a position and they kind of give an individual contributor role, and then they give them one person to supervise. And then two people, and they sort of work their way up. The kind of human being we want as a leader does two things. One, they're actually competent. They're good at bringing resources, they're good at developing people, they're good at making sure that stuff's divided up fairly, all that kind of stuff. They know how to hunt, you know, in the old sort of days, or farm, depending on the society. And then the other thing is that they treat people with compassion and generosity and fairly. So the way I do it is, there's two things. There's the performance part of the job, and there's the humanity part of the job. And at least from my perspective, if you're just the kind of boss, and there's evidence to support this too, who is great at getting the work done and you destroy people along the way, you make them feel like dirt, you leave them having mental health problems, you keep all the goodies for yourself, to me, you might be the richest person in the world or win the most games if it's sports, whatever, but to me, you're still a lousy boss. And I don't want to work for you, and I think that people like that do damage to society and to human beings. On the other hand, there is the really nice boss who's really incompetent. They're just as bad. And in some ways, it's almost worse because, like, people feel so bad about getting rid of them or leaving them or making them feel bad. So to me, it's this ability to sort of do both. And one thing that every boss knows is it's a balancing act. That over time, it's like there's sometimes when you've got to, for the good of the whole, make people feel bad, push them a little bit too hard. But what the smart bosses do is they realize it's a balancing act, and they build up some humanity points to burn. And then when they burn too many, they sort of like come back and make people feel good. You know, sometimes you can have both at the same time. But as I always say, being a good boss is something you don't do all at once. It involves a long-term time perspective. The hallmark of a boss who allows innovation to happen is that they allow failure. Failure sucks, but instructs. And so this notion of celebrating failure, it actually usually does suck. When your product doesn't work, when you don't make money, I mean, a lot of bad things can happen. But nonetheless, the best bosses treat failure as an opportunity, as we describe it, to forgive and remember. So you forgive people to create psychological safety, and you remember so you learn and you don't make the same mistakes over and over again, and everybody sort of learns about it. That's everything from a good product manager to a good nurse supervisor in a hospital. That's the kind of environment that good leaders will create. Another thing that good leaders do to create innovation is that they make it safe for people to fight in an atmosphere of mutual respect. A good creative leader makes it safe for people to engage in constructive conflict, and also to have those, if you will, intelligent failures that suck, but you still learn from them. There's lots of things that get in the way of turning knowledge into action, but I guess I would pick two. For starters, what good bosses do is they create a world where they don't reward smart talk. And there's lots of organizations that reward just smart talkers and fancy plans and everything. What they do is they reward people who actually, in the end, get things done. And it sounds so simple, it's ridiculous, but too many organizations have reward systems that reward political behavior and so on. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is something that I've gotten quite obsessed with, which is that one of the big impediments to turning knowledge into action is that organizations will create these reward systems where the way that you, in status systems and glory systems, the way you get ahead is by, it's sort of like being the person, the individual star who makes great things happen. And when that system happens, what happens is people will start treating one another as enemies, because the way they get ahead is by being number one in the company independently of what's best for the company. So the thing that I always say, if you want to cut through all the stuff about the best reward system and so on, the one test I would use is I'd ask the question, who is a superstar? And if you start looking at really the organizations that are great at knowing what to do and doing it, even though they have really varied reward systems, I almost always come back to that. It's somebody who gets ahead by helping the people around him or her succeed, not by stomping on the others. And that helps you close the knowing-doing gap, because the focus is on what's best for the organization or the group as a whole, not just for me to get mine, to get as rich and famous as possible.